Here are 10 things that you must know before working with LED strips so you don't waste your time and your money. Now, buying LED strips can be overwhelming because there's just a ton of options. I did an Amazon search and there are over 3,000 different results. So I'm going to help you sort through that today and what to look for to make sure you have a successful project. Now, the first thing to know is that there are better options out there. Now, the first thing you're going to see when you search for LED light strips are these packaged kits. Now, this little guy is under $20 for 100 feet of LED lights. And as you can imagine, they're not very good. And if you've spent more than 5 seconds on TikTok, you've probably seen these. I think they're in the Teenage Influencer Starter Kit. Now, there are definitely higher quality kits out there, but they're going to cost you 3 to 4 times as much as this cheap one. And the problem with kits, though, is if you don't like the remote control or how they connect Wi-Fi versus Bluetooth, and especially if you want more LEDs per meter, then you're really just stuck with it. So you kind of get what you get and don't throw a fit. But I'm my own man, and I'm going to choose what I want. So I build my own kits. Now, building your own kit is not that hard. You only need 3 basic things, and that is the LED strips, a way to control them, and a way to power them. Even though there's only 3 components, there are a ton of options, especially for LEDs. So the second thing you need to know is what you want your LEDs to do. Now, obviously you're using LED lights because you want to shed some light on things, whether that is just white light that you're using for under cabinet kitchen lighting, or maybe you want to add a little bit of flare and add some color and go with an RGB. And I'm going to put those into 2 categories, dumb RGBs and smart RGBs. And here's a quick overview of how each of these work. Now, with the white LEDs, pretty self-explanatory. It is just like a light bulb. You have a positive and negative lead from your power supply, and when you turn it on, it gives you a white light. And you can increase and decrease the brightness just like you would with a dimmer switch for a light bulb in your house. Now, the dumb RGBs are a bit the same, except now you're sending 3 signals down the path. Red, green, and blue. That's what the RGB stands for. But the thing is these are not smart. So every LED on the strip is going to be the same color based upon how much power you're putting into each of the red, green, and blue. So if I turn these on, when it's white, that means all of the red, green, and blue are turned up all the way. But if I hit the red button, now the red is getting full power and the green and the blue are not getting any power. So you can kind of think about it like that. Like there's 3 dimmer switches, and depending upon how you turn them, that's what generates the color. And then lastly, we have these smart RGBs. Now these are very different. They do have a positive and a negative, but then they have a data pin coming down the middle. And the data pin basically is telling the light what to do. The cool thing is that it can tell each individual LED what to do. And that's how you can get some really cool animations like this. So you can do some really cool things. Now, this is just stock animations that are in this controller, which I'll talk about later, but each individual LED along the way has its own instructions. So you might be thinking, Kent, RGBs just do white anyway? And you are correct. But the third thing to know about LED strips is the white isn't always right. And so I've got all the LEDs here together. Let me turn them all on. So on this first one here, these are a dedicated white LED. That's the only color it does. And this is, I think, 4000 Kelvin. You can get those in different color temperatures. And this looks really great. It's a nice, pure white light. Now in the middle here, this one is the $20 kit. And I don't know if you can see it as good as I can, but it looks really blue. It's kind of nasty. Now this last one here is the smart RGB, and you can start to see some of the quality differences between it and this cheap dumb RGB. This white is a lot better, but it's still not quite as nice as the pure white. So if you're thinking it'd be nice to have RGBs, but I'm going to mainly do white, I would probably just make the decision to go for the pure white if you're concerned about how that is going to look and the temperature of the light. There is one other type of LED strip that tries to get the best of both worlds, and that's an RGBW. And as it sounds, it combines an RGB plus a white all into one little LED cell. Now, the problem with that is that you got a lot going on there. The reviews are not great on them. It's more to fail. And for me personally, I just don't think it's worth it. Because if you're that concerned about getting a really nice natural white, then just go with the white. And if you're not concerned, then just go with the RGB. And that white that comes off it is going to be good enough for most applications. I don't want to bog you down with a bunch of model numbers, but in general, the dumb RGBs are going to be referred to as an RGB 50-50. And the 50-50 just refers to the size of the LED. And for the smart RGBs, you'll see a lot of different options. You might see a WB2811, 12B, 13, and 15, and those all have just little different nuances. Now, there's a great video by The Hookup, and I'll have that linked down below, where he goes through all the different options and what each of those model numbers mean. But just for the record, I use the WS2812B. That's my go-to strip. Now that we know the color type, the fourth thing you need to think about is how many LEDs do you want in a specific distance? And the measurement that they typically do is LEDs per meter. So I have four new strips here in front of me, going from the least up to the most amount of density of LEDs. So starting over here on your left, these are the dumb LEDs, and they come in that 100-foot kit, and that's two rolls of 50 feet. And the reason they can do that is because there's only 15 LEDs per meter. That is like the bare minimum, and that equates to about 2.5-inch spacing in between the LEDs. So the next step up is 30 LEDs per meter, twice as much, which will give you about 1.25 inches in between them. Then we step up to 60 LEDs per meter, about 3/4 inch between. And then we go all the way up to 144 LEDs per meter. This thing is just chock full of LEDs. They're like only 1/4 inch apart, and this one is the most dense. But what do you really need? Let me show you how they look under diffusion. So the biggest thing with the density of LEDs is the more you have in a smaller space, the brighter it will be, as well as the less obvious it will be that there are individual LEDs, and it will look like a constant source. And obviously, the more you have per meter, the more expensive it's going to be per meter. When we add the diffuser, it helps blend things out, and here's how that looks. Now, personally, my go-to is the 60 LEDs per meter because I like that tighter look for the animations. But if you're just trying to do some ambiance lighting and just get a mood going, I think the 30 per meter would be fine, and you're going to save yourself a little bit of money. All right, I think we have gotten the use out of these dumb RGBs in this cheap kit, and we're just going to toss those over there. Now, as far as these black ones right here that you saw, you may have noticed that they looked a little bit different, and that leads into the next thing you want to look out for, which is, where are you going to be using them in relationship to moisture and water? And this is probably the easiest decision of them all, because there's only three different types of water ratings, and they're pretty easy to figure out. So if you see IP30, that is this guy right here, which has basically no water resistance. All the component wheel locks. As I was saying, the IP30 has no water resistance whatsoever, and it is just all the exposed circuitry. So you can see the little pads here, and if water hit there and crossed over those, it would short it out and ruin your strip. Now, the next level up is IP65, and that is water resistant. This one has a nice silicone coating over the top of it. So if you look at it from the side, it's kind of bulged up, and that is just covering all the electronics on the front side with a layer of silicone so that the water, if you get it splashed up there, you're gonna be okay. And these would be great for in the kitchen, anywhere around a sink where it might get water, and maybe outdoors if you were undercover, like up on a porch or something like that. Now, the last rating is IP67, and that is waterproof. So these are inside a silicone casing that is sealed, and you can see here at the ends, they also have had those sealed there. So you could get all kinds of water on these. I did see someone in the Amazon review said, can I mount these in my pool? No, do not do that. This could take a lot of water, but I would absolutely not recommend to put them underwater. So if you're gonna do anything outdoors, then this is the way you're gonna wanna go. The sixth thing you'll see different among LED strips is the voltage. And you will typically see 5, 12, and 24 volt options. Now, as you go up in voltage, it does not necessarily get brighter in the specific LEDs. So 5 volt versus 12 volt, if you're running one LED, they're gonna be the same brightness. But the more volts you have, the more LEDs you can run at full voltage, if you think about it that way. So you might just think, why not just use 24 volt all the time? But there are some advantages using the lower voltage strips. I like to use the 5 volt strips a lot, and that's a lot of what I have here. And that's because you can run those off of an Arduino, which has a 5 volt output. You can also run those off of a USB charger, which I done in the floating shelf video, because little battery banks like this one are 5 volts, and that's what I've been powering these strips with. So you could plug that into any of your cell phone chargers and power some of these strips, or power it off of your computer. A general rule of thumb is you can drive about 100 5 volt LEDs with the standard power supply, which is probably 2 amps. And with the 12 volts, you can go around to 230, 240 LEDs, and with a 24 volt, again, you can double that again to around 460 to 480. When you are past 100 LEDs on 5 volts, it's not like they just shut off. You just start losing color degradation, especially in the white. I've got a strip right here. This is a 5-meter strip that has 60 LEDs per meter at 5 volts. And this is my favorite strip, the WS 2812B, and I will have links to these in the description. Now, all strips are going to have a different power draw depending upon how many LEDs you have and the voltage. Now, this strip here is 90 watts and 300 LEDs, so it's like I have 300 little 0.3 watt light bulbs. But that's at full brightness on all the RGB scales, so most of the time it's going to operate well below that. And I'm just driving these off of a little wall plug that runs at 2 amps. And when I turn it on, it actually looks great. It's running all 300 LEDs and everything looks fine. So how does that work? And that's because these aren't using the full 0.3 watts. They're only using a portion of the channels of the red, green, and blue to make the colors, and maybe they're running at a little bit lower brightness, which in essence will allow me to double or triple the amount of LEDs that I can drive. But when we go to white, that's a different story. Now I've got the brightness down and all the LEDs look very similar and an even color. But as I start turning up the brightness, they start to fall off in color right around this 100 LED mark. And if I keep going, they really get orange at the end and then the lights start flashing. Basically it's saying you're trying to draw too much current and I'm gonna shut down or overheat. And that brings us to the seventh thing that you need to know, which is choosing your power supply or adding another one. Now, when you have more voltage, that means you can get more wattage at the same amperage because watts is just volts times amps. So if you get double the voltage, you can get double the watts, which means you can power twice as many LEDs. So if I'm using a 5-volt strip, I can't really change that up and increase the voltage because you will burn out the LEDs. But what you can do is increase the other part of the equation, which is the amperage. What you can do is add more power into the strip with a second power supply or a second wall brick. So I've got my little 2-amp wall charger. We got that plugged in here, and that will only drive us to about 100 LEDs. But I also have this power supply, which is an adjustable power supply, and it goes all the way up to 24 volts, but I'm gonna crank that down to 5 volts. But we're gonna apply the power to the other end of the strip and see if it turns that yellow into white. You can just inject power at any of these little pieces, and they even have little wires on the end that you could attach to, but just for now, I'm gonna do it right on the pad. I put the 5 volt on here, and there you go, look at that. It changes to the same color and a nice bright white. And there's a little bit of squealing, that's actually from the power supply because it's a piece of junk. So applying power into the end or the middle of the strip, they call power injection. But the other way to do it is just to put more power at the beginning with a larger power supply. You can get bigger power supplies like this one right here. This is 60 amps at 5 volts. So that should be more than enough to fully power this 90 watt strip. But those bigger power supplies are typically for large installations. I don't ever use those. I will either use the wall outlet, and if I need some more amperage, I will upgrade to one that's like a 5-amp adapter, and that will obviously give you a lot more runtime. For me, this has always worked because I'm usually only running 3 to 4 feet at a time. Now that we have the LEDs and the power supplies, the eighth thing to know is how do you control these? So there are different types of controllers, and they're basically what give the instructions to the LEDs. And like everything else, there are options. So on the easy side, we have these inline controllers, and that's what I've been using to power these. So this is just a little receiver, and it's got instructions already programmed on it for some different options that line up with the remote. And all you have to do is put this in line with the power source, and it goes out to the strip, and you can control it. And in the middle, you're gonna have controllers that you're gonna have to wire and put power to. And I have an example here. And honestly, I don't have a lot of these because I just don't use them. I'm either on the easy end or on the more advanced end. The nice thing about these is you could add in things like Wi-Fi. You could associate these with your home assistant, whether that's Google or the Amazon equivalent. And that gives you some options to have more configurability and to use apps and control things on your phone. And then the option that I love and also love to hate are the microcontrollers. And these are all basically little computers and goes from little things like this little D1 WeMOS Mini to an Arduino Nano, an ESP32, or a full-sized Arduino Uno. And basically, like I said, these are just computers that you can actually write the code and put it on them. And so that way you have complete control over what's happening, timings and everything, and you can write all those scripts. Now, if programming's not your thing, that's okay, because there's an application called WLED, and basically they've done it all for you. And it will connect into your microcontroller and basically give it all the instructions. And so you can just go up there, you can choose different animations. They have a ton of them in there. It's what I used on my party coffee table to get all those cool animations and even have it react to music. If you're just getting started with LEDs, I would highly recommend to start with the easy option, and I'll have a link down below to this one, which is my favorite, and it's inexpensive and easy to use. And then as you grow in your LED projects, you can start trying the microcontrollers, WLED, and even maybe program something yourself. So I've been showing you these rolls of LEDs. They're 5 meters or 16.4 feet for my American friends. But most of the time, you're not gonna use the whole roll, probably almost all the time. So the ninth thing you need to know is how to cut the LED strips, how to connect them, and how to get exactly the size that you want for your project. Now, every LED strip has a place where you can cut them to size, and it is where the copper is exposed, and basically that's so that you could solder or connect them together. But how far apart those are spaced depends upon the type of the LED strip. So on these 5-volt LED strips, these are the individually addressable ones, there is a cut space in between every single LED. So you can go in the increments of how far apart the LEDs are. When you go up to most 12-volt LEDs, they start being paired into groups of 3 LEDs in between the pads where you can cut at. And when you go up to 24-volt, it goes all the way up to 6 or 8 LEDs in between the cut spots. Now on some of the pads, you're going to see this, and this is a little solder joint. And that's just where they attach the strips when they're in the manufacturing process, because they only have so long of a length before they need to add more on. And you could do the exact same thing when you start cutting them up and rearranging strips. And to cut the strips to length, all you need is just a regular pair of scissors. And you just go right to where that pad is, and you want to cut it just right down the middle. So now you've got these two pieces and you have the little copper pads here that are exposed, and now you can make a connection with those. Now to join two strips together, soldering is definitely gonna be the best connection. It's gonna be the best electrical and it's gonna be the strongest. But if you don't wanna solder, they have some other options for you. They make these little plastic connectors that have basically jumpers on them, and you can just connect the pieces right in there and snap them together. So if you wanted to extend a strip, or maybe you wanted to make a 90 degree turn, or maybe you wanted to join 3 parts together. You could do that all with these connectors. I do prefer to solder my connections, and that's what I've done in most of my projects, because putting them together with these is kind of a pain in the butt. Just make sure you line everything up the correct way. And the LED strips are hard to get under those pins because they just want to crinkle. So you have to kind of pry up the pins a little bit. But when you close it back down, it should make a nice connection. Now that you've got all your LEDs figured out, you've got them wired, how are you going to mount them? Where are you going to put them? That's the last thing you need to think about. Now, there are a lot of different options, and almost every LED strip comes with adhesive on the back, and you can just peel it and stick it on. Now, a lot of these adhesives that you get with some of the cheaper strips, they might just fall right off. And even my favorite strips, these ones from BTF Lighting that I've been showing, and BTF Lighting is not sponsoring this or anything, I just really have had a great experience with their product. But they have two varieties. So the one I've been showing you is the WS2812B Eco, and this one runs on a little bit lower wattage, but also the back is a little bit different adhesive. You see, this is just this blue adhesive, and this is more of a generic. Whereas on the other version that's a little more expensive, it's the exact same thing as far as the lights per meter and everything. It has 3M tape on the back. So if you have something that has the 3M, the 200MP or something like that, that's a pretty good adhesive and that is gonna stay in place. But if you don't have that, you're definitely gonna wanna reinforce the strips as you put them up and don't rely on the adhesive. And some of these strips will even come with a little baggie of clips, and these are just adhesive that you can stick up and then slide the LED right underneath there. But there's lots of other options online if you just search for LED strip mounts. But what's probably more important is how are you going to diffuse the light when it's mounted? So earlier I showed you this little diffusion panel, and that comes with this little aluminum mount. Now this aluminum channel is probably the most popular way to put LEDs in. You put your LED strip right inside and then you put the diffuser on top. And that way it kind of evens out the LEDs and looks nicer. Now they do have this channel in different profiles. They have some that go up in corners and they have some that are deeper or wider depending upon the type of LED strip you have. So just make sure you know the width of your LED strip and match it up with the profile you want. Using the aluminum channel, it helps dissipate heat as well as you have access to it in case anything goes wrong. But there is one last style of LEDs that I want to show you that actually have diffuser built in. And you may have seen these in the recent floating shelf video I did, and those are FCOB LEDs. That stands for flexible chip on board. And it has this little silicone coating over the top, but it's also made of hundreds of tiny little LEDs. This actually has 480 LEDs per meter. If you get in real tight there, you might be able to make them out. If you want to see my projects where I've used LEDs for some ideas, I got a playlist queued up for you right there. A big thank you to the FTBT Builders Club. I'm Brad, and until next time, get out there and build something awesome.